your kids too, especially Josh.
I'm going to just stand here. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to see you guys. Keep some people in prayer. We do have a lot of people that have called sick. They're not feeling well, so we know that Delta virus is out there. We want to keep safe. We want to keep healthy. But thank you guys for being here. Thank you for following the rules. Keeping, you know, if you're not vaccinated, please keep your masks on if you're up and about. If you are, you can move about the cabin freely. But thank you all for coming. What a wonderful day. Thank you for your prayers as we were on vacation this past week and visiting family. And it's always a good thing. And it was sunny. It was supposed to rain the whole time, just like our last vacation. And yet, every day we had sun, beautiful sun. And I think it rained maybe once or twice. And it was at a time when we were like, please rain, it's hot. And so, praise the Lord, we did get the rain when we did. But one of the things that Lisa and I like to do when we're on vacation is we like to look for birds. And it's kind of like Jack Black. We want to have a good bird year and see all the different birds. But this year, it's butterflies. So we're out there and we're looking, going all throughout the areas on vacation, and we saw about 7 or 8 different types of butterflies. It was incredible. God just kept bringing them by us, and they would flutter by, you know, as they're called, the old names, flutter by, and right in our faces. I'm trying to take a picture, and some would land, and some would dart quickly, and some were just, I don't know how they fly so efficiently so fast, because there was a yellow one I could never get a picture of, and it would just fly like 100 yards in a second. I'm like, how is he flying so fast? But just an incredible thing, and I think about butterflies, I can't help but think about the metamorphosis of what happens to a Christian or one who is walking in the world dead, and then the life of God is breathed into them through their belief in Jesus Christ and the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's truly even a greater conversion than a butterfly. But as we think about these butterflies and the science behind it, it's interesting. It says inside a cocoon, or what most people call a cocoon, is really a chrysalis. The caterpillar is transformed to a new creature. Fluid breaks down from an old caterpillar body to cells that are called imaginal cells. Interestingly enough, imagination of God. You know, these imaginal cells, so everything's broke down into this little soup of imaginal cells. Imaginal cells are undifferentiated cells, which means they can become any type of cell. So whatever God desires, he can make in this little cocoon, if you will. Many of these imaginal cells are used to form the new body. So in this little chrysalis, there's something that's taking place. And some of us, we don't realize it, but what happens as you buried yourself in Christ, just like a seed, it must die before it breathes back into new life. And something happens inside of that seed where germination has already taken place, and it's there, but we don't know what it's going to burst forth to yet until it comes through the ground, until water gets it just right, the sun hits it, and all of a sudden a miracle takes place and the seed bursts to new life. And that's exactly what happens to us as Christians. We're new creatures, and yet some of us still are living in the old way. We're still crawling on the ground in the dirt with our face in the dirt as the serpent was cursed in the Garden of Eden, that he would crawl all his days in the dirt, and we're still like a caterpillar. When the Lord says you can fly, you can raise up like eagle's wings, you can run and not grow weary and faint. You're like that yellow butterfly that's fluttering and no one knows what direction you're going. Boom, all of a sudden you're all the way over there. It's amazing. And yet I hear some people, I seen it on a group text, it kind of drove me crazy, because I see some people, and we all do it, we start to reminisce about the good old days. And my brother-in-law, he has a band, and he used to sing this song. It would drive me crazy, bring back the good old days. Bring back those good old days. I'm like, no, bury those bad old days. I don't want nothing to do with those old days. That was what captivated me. That's what consumed me. That's what brought pain and hopelessness and torture and torment and shame and guilt. All those things that I saw, death, that overwhelmed my mind even. And I was out of my mind and doing crazy things. That was not where I want to go back to. I understand there's things that we have in common that are good that we kind of reminisce about. But I was on that group text and people started talking about all the musics that they used to listen to. And then I'm like, yeah, you know, it was a catchy tune. That used to be what got me, was a catchy tune where it had a good beat. But then all of a sudden you listen to the words, you know, pop a cap in the church. And I'm like, whoa, what's this? I don't want to pop a cap in anybody. You know, it's like, no, that's not what I'm saying. That's not me. That's the old me. Right then I was popping out of the Wild West. But no, I don't want to harm anybody. I don't want to go there or smoke and dope and drug and drink. No, no. I want to be in my right mind. I want to be sober-minded. The Lord has given me His word that I can have a light in this dark place and move through it. As we enter into Romans chapter 6, it's a great chapter of metamorphosis. We're only going to touch on the first 11 verses, but it's an exciting thing to read. It's also a convicting thing to read for some of us. It's also an eye-opener, a stirring up, an encouragement. Get back on the right path. What matters to you? What matters? Who are we now? Are we back where we were, or are we freedmen? We're freedmen in Christ Jesus. Paul's been talking to them about no longer being under the law of condemnation. No longer being under that which showed them the target that they were missing. And we're going to see there's a new target that we're heading for now. It's not one that we can't hit. It's makeable because Christ has made it for us. We are on a new path. We're in a new way. Let's read what Paul's saying as he's, again, writing this romance letter or this letter of salvation, this letter to the Romans, who he knows he's going to get there eventually, but he doesn't know when, so he's writing this letter, and we're continuing on in verse 1 of chapter 6. It says, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?" Remember, he said, where sin abounds, grace all the more. We're no longer under the law. The law brought condemnation, which pointed us to how we missed the target, and now God says, "I move your arrow. You hit the bullseye because I give you grace. You aimed wrong. You didn't use the right techniques. You were failing miserably, but I moved it. I guided your arrow just as I guided the rock of David to hit Goliath square in the head. Not just hit him, but penetrate and cause death and make him fall." God hits the mark. And if we're in God, we always will hit the mark. Period. That's what grace says. It says, "I have unmerited favor. I take your iniquities, I take your failures, I take your missing parameters, and I put them perfect. I make them right." That's a joyous thing for a Christian, isn't it? That's the good news, the gospel message that we receive, that there's nothing I can do. I've already proved that in the good old ways. I failed miserably. I constantly was tormented, filled with shame and guilt. And look at the destruction I left behind me. I don't want to look back at that, right? I don't want to see that. And yet God says, "I've made a new way, and I've cleaned your path straight ahead. I've gone before you even, so that you can walk on the straight and narrow path." So, it says that we can sometimes, why is he saying this? Because sometimes we can take our liberty that we have in Christ and use that liberty for an occasion to sin. And what does he say here? The very first words of verse 2 should be what we should say every time the old nature enters into our thoughts, or we start down that wrong path, we look the wrong direction, we look twice in the wrong direction at that thing that's luring us, lusting us, keeping us going the wrong way. What should we say? What does it say in verse 2? The verse 2 words should be your power. They should be your might. They should be your authority that you've been given by God Almighty and the Spirit of God. God forbid. God forbid. What's that? It's the exact opposite of amen. Amen is the Lord. Whatever He is, will be. They call Him the amen in Revelation. It also means let it be as He wills. Let it come to pass. Well, what's God forbid say? Let it never come to pass. Let this die. Let this be not mentioned so much among you. God forbid it. Does that put me under a new law? The law, the old law, the old way, the old ways of condemnation? No, God forbid. But what it's saying is Christ didn't die in vain. Christ made us new creatures so that we would walk in a new way, that we would be a new heart, a new mind, a new spirit, a new energy, a new strength to go right, to go the right way. Not to continue to go back to that which causes death and harm. He says, God forbid we should take this liberty and flaunt it and walk. Now, will I sin all the more? I think it was Rasmussen was one of a guy way back in several thousand years ago who would flaunt his sin and said, I'm showing the love of the Lord and I'm showing the grace of God, so I'm going to sin more and more and more so everyone will see that. I hate to say it, but there's some words that are sobering to every Christian that's out there, or non-Christian who pretends to be a Christian, the Lord says when they come before him, and he says, I've done these things all in your name, he says, depart from me, you doer of iniquity, I never knew you. You were never mine. You never converted, metamorphosis in that cocoon. You never turned into a new creature. You were always the same. You look the same. You've done nothing different. That should be our indicator, is usually there's a dramatic difference in somebody who asked Jesus into their heart. From where they were to where they're at now. There is a dramatic difference in their lifestyle, in what pleases them and what displeases them, what gives them pleasure, what doesn't give them pleasure, what God forbid, it may lure them, but they say, God forbid, that's not who I am anymore. We are a peculiar people, and we're going to touch on this. We're ambassadors of a new kingdom, a new place, a new and everlasting place. This is a tough thing to grasp, isn't it? Because we're like, wait a minute, but I just ran out of all this guilt and shame. I just got out of it. Now you have the authority to rebuke that sin. Now you are a child of God who has the authority to even rebuke the devil. When the devil comes, you can rebuke him in the name of Jesus Christ. And all those things that you've been given power now. Some of us are walking around powerless and not encouraging one another to walk in the strength of the Lord. Instead, discouraging one another by continuing in the old lifestyle, causing confusion. Think of what a sin that would be. Think of how much you think, we talked about this last week, it's just you. It's not just you. You are part of a body. You are part of a bigger purpose. Everything you do affects the whole body. When you lead a life that's duplicity or double-minded and going one way and then going another way and flaunting your liberty, you're confusing the world. And you're confusing your brothers and sisters. And then they slip. You cause them to slip. This is why we understand why the Bible says, God forbid that this never happen. All right, let's put it in a better way. You and I all consider we're consenting adults. Whatever I consent in, it's my will, it's my life, I can do. What about if those are children in Christ, newborn babies, people who have just accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, because the Bible says there is newborn babies, they're drinking milk, and they're trying to get their life back on track. Now, here comes a seasoned Christian, walking in the way they walked prior to being saved. That newborn baby looks and says, oh, there's nothing different here than there is where I was. And then they stay in whatever it is the Lord's trying to keep them out of or free them from. Those pains. If you look at the little baby Cassie on the floor, imagine if her parents were walking in a way that would be harmful to Cassie. Cassie doesn't know any different. Cassie's going, I must follow. Why does it say God forbid? Because we've been called to love. We've been called to walk and example out the new way that's been put before us, to follow hard those things in Christ. So he says, God forbid, how shall we then that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Why is it possible, is really what he's saying, that we who've been risen from the grave and put to death the sin with Christ on the cross, how is it that we now want to live in that death? I think about the prodigal son, and he took his father's inheritance. He wanted the money. That's all he wanted. He didn't see the benefit was just being with his father, being with the family, being in the house of the Lord. He didn't see any benefit in that. Much like there's a lot of in America, the dying church. I see no benefit in coming to the church. Well, there may be a reason why you see no benefit coming to open up and expound upon the illumination of the words of God that are eternal. Because your mind is temporary. Because your goal in your life is temporary. Everything you're living for is now and here and not in the future. And therefore you have no benefit of coming to hear the words of eternity. You have no benefit to come and see the power of God and the transformation he wants to do through the word of God. And the renewing of your mind. Instead, we're continually being conformed into the image of death, which was the cross. Christ put that to death on the cross. And yet we still live in that. longer, it says. And it says in verse 3, know you not that many as of us that were baptized in Jesus were baptized into his death? Do you not know that you put yourself to death? Remember, some of you, many of you I baptized, and I said, buried in the likeness of Christ's death, risen in his life. Right? You're buried. It's gone. It's so amazing how much we cling to. The problem with going back to old sin and being like the prodigal, we steal that inheritance. We don't like the house of God. We don't like the presence of being with God. Is we get out there and we start to get lured. And it's never a quick destruction. Very rarely. It's always a slow fall. And slowly Satan strips you naked and exposes you and then eventually seeks to kill you. And where do you end up? You end up in the slop. You end up with the pigs. In the swine pool, in the mud, on the ground like a caterpillar, when you're supposed to be a butterfly. And now you're there, and you look up. You have to look up, and you say, even the very worst place in church, or in God, in his house, is better than all this world has to offer to me. Look what it's left me. Look where it's left me. And the prodigal son comes back to the father. And the father's always waiting with those open arms, to embrace, to restore, to reconcile back into relationship and fellowship through grace, through mercies. But could you imagine if the prodigal son story that Jesus told said, and then the son got back into the house, they threw the big party, and then he said, you know what, I like this party. I'm going to go back out and party. I want to party forever. See you later, Dad. And he left again and went right back to the pig swap. But the Lord says, he said, listen, Proverbs chapter 26, verse 11 says, as a dog runneth to his vomit, so a fool returneth to his folly. And that same scripture verse is reiterated, repeated by Peter in 2 Peter chapter 2. And it says, it's talking about people who would come and play at and kind of pretend. He says, there are stains in your feasts together. And it says, wherein, verse 11, as angels, which are greater power than might, bring not railing accusations against them before the Lord. But these are natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed, seeking, speak evil of things they do not understand, and shall utterly perish in their own corruption, and shall receive the reward of their unrighteousness, as they count it pleasure to riot in the day, spots and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. They have eyes full of adultery, and that cannot cease from sinning, beguile unstable souls, a heart they have exercised with covetous practices, causing children, cursed children, which have forsaken the right way and gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Bozer, who loveth the wages of unrighteousness, but was rebuked for his iniquity. The dumb donkey speaking with a man's voice forbade the madness of the prophet. So God has put this path before them. This is kind of the Bible talks about those that have tasted of righteousness. They've never received in their heart. They've never gone to death. They've never put to death the old way. They've never got to the point where they said, I need a Savior. My ways are wrong and your ways are right. This is a painful thing for some people that just have what's called I hate to say this, but like a prison conversion. Or someone who's going through a very tough time and then they ask the Lord into their heart just to get out of it. I just need out of this. But they never really put to death themselves. They never really enter in a new life. They never say, I was wrong and you are right. What I'm doing has been wrong. I need your right thinking in my mind. I need your right spirit in my heart. I need to be changed. I understand there's no good thing in me. Not anything I do will work. Please take this life. Lead me home. That's follow. I want to follow you, Lord. I want to do your ways. So he says in verse 4, it says, therefore, we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead, the glory of the Father, even so, should walk in the newness of new life. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new." Is there a newness in your life? Do we walk from newness to newness? Again, what's the relevancy of coming together and fellowshipping one with another? Why does the Lord say, "Be iron sharpening iron"? Why does he say, "Renew your mind continually"? Why does he say, "Be ye filled continually with the Spirit of God"? Because we can have the spirit of Antichrist in us. We can have the spirit of the wrongness. We can constantly get dirty in the pig slop and then be bogged down instead of walking in the newness of life. The Lord says, put it on daily. Put on. It sounds like a garment. We can go to the closet, and we can kind of, you know, when you're on vacation, you live out of the bag. You wear clothes maybe a few more times than you probably should. You know, the shorts are still standing up on their own. You're like, yeah, that's all right. No one knows the difference. And you're wearing stinky shorts you've been wearing for like 3-4 days. And, you know, shirts, you're like, I can't get away with that one. Maybe a few colognes. Still do it. Let's go. We're good. You know, we start doing things, and we start compromising. In life, it's the same way, isn't it? We start to say, it's nothing big. It's little. It's small. It's still standing. That's all right. It's stinking. I know, but a little cologne will cover that. Why? We're new. We should continually walk in that newness. What stirs a heart sometimes to sin? I'm bored. I'm bored. We've got the 20-something things we're trying to put together for this week on Friday. And it's a tough thing for these 20-something people. They're being challenged all the time, and they're being tempted by older Christians who are walking the wrong way, but also by people in their own generation that are telling them, "You're missing out. You don't understand this newness." And it's funny, Satan always gets us with this lie of newness. He says, "This is, you know, get with the." I remember it was like, "Get with the 90s, man. Come on, everybody's doing this. You know, this is that was the old way of thinking." Then it was, "Get with the 20, you know, millennium. Come on, the millennium people. Everyone's doing this. This is the way it is." And we think, what sin today? What thing are we doing for pleasure that's contrary to God is new? Name it. Homosexuality? Is that new? No. That's not a new lifestyle. That's old. It's been around for years. Sodom and Gomorrah, right? There's been all kinds of sin that hurts people, harm people, things that hurt a mind, that's been there since the beginning of the fall of mankind. Drinking to drunkenness, that's new? No. Pharmakia, drugs, no. It's been around forever. What's new that's tempting you? What new experience are you looking for that's the old nature that harms you? Puts you back in the slop and wants to captivate your mind, your heart, your soul, and put you back in the mud. Yet the Lord says, "I make all things new." Anyone who's received the Lord Jesus Christ in their heart, no, we don't worship the creation anymore. But boy, do we see the beauty in the artist. Don't we? As we're seeing the sunsets and we're looking at the ocean and we're seeing the clouds come down, Lisa's kind of not feeling well. We're having a romantic time on the beach with ants biting us and laying in the sand. We're trying to enjoy ourselves and this stinky smell's coming off the ocean, death or something. There's fish dying all around because they got red tide. And then everyone's trying to take a breath of red tide and that causes your breath to, "Isn't this great?" And there's this cloud that looks like a nuclear bomb gone off on the horizon. And the sun's coming down to it. And Lisa's like, I hope that sun goes behind us, we can go in. So the sun does eventually go behind that nuclear bomb. We're like, all right, party's over, let's go inside. But that's how it is, right? At first it looks appealing. Sin's always that way. It's pleasurable for a season. But then the reality of it kicks in that we've been made aware of. But the Lord gives us new things. As I look at the sunset, every sunset is a new picture. And it's a new imagination, or imagine yourself. It could be anything, right? We look at the clouds and the sunset's just fantastic here at the lake or anywhere. You driving by to our house through the park, you look across Churchill Park, you see the sun going down. Different nights, it's just fantastic. The butterflies, everything is more colorful when you're with the Lord and you see the Creator. There's nothing held back that's good for you. As a matter of fact, it's amplified. Every day is a new day that's been given to you by God Almighty. He says, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Can you rejoice even in the things that are going around you, like red tide and COVID and jobs, you know, having people not getting jobs, all the politics that are going on around us? Is everything new to you? Do you wake up like a little child, excited for the day? What has God done? Well, this is the same thing as yesterday. No, it's not the same thing as yesterday. God has created a special day for you today, and he will do it again tomorrow, and he'll do it again the next day. Some of you know I create a devotion, and that devotion that I create, I just read a chapter in the morning, and however the Lord speaks to me, I kind of sum it up, and I throw it onto a devotion. And the way I do it now is I used to hard copy that to everybody. I send it to like 60 people every morning. I pray for everybody. I'm sending it out. But then I start saying, you know, this is taking a lot of time. Maybe I'll put it out on the website. I'll still pray for everybody, but I'll just send them a link to the devotion. The problem is now they don't have a history. My brother says the difference is I used to be able to go back a couple days and look at the devotion a couple days ago. Now every link goes to the same devotion, which is today's devotion. And I said, that's because it's today's manna. That's because yesterday's manna is gone. This is for today. Today's a new day. Today's a day that God has prepared for you. Are you walking in the newness? Do you see the joy of walking on the path that God has given us? It's not a boring path at all. That's the lie that Satan tells us, to keep us looking for that thing to fill the void. But God says, I'm a God of new. I make all things new. You are new every day. I create in you a new spirit every day. Praise the Lord. That's a good thing for us that have had a bad past. Right? I don't have to remember the sins of the past or go back to them. Why do you think Satan tries to tempt a Christian who's given their heart to the Lord to go back to the vomit? So he can heap on you that same condemnation. He can remind you, you're no different now than you ever were. Which isn't true. It's simply not true. You're a new creature, and you've gone back to that vomit. There are those that are not new creatures that are pretending, that never left the vomit. There's a difference. Listen, turn with me to Philippians chapter 3 in your Bibles, please. Philippians chapter 3. Beginning in verse 8, it says, yea, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Jesus Christ my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. I do count them but dung. Those are pretty strong words from Paul. I count everything from the past that I ever was, everything I ever had, as poop. For those of you that don't know what dung is, it's poop, animal excrement, poop. I consider it filth. Everything from my past. Do we say that? Do we have this faith in our heart that in comparison to what God has for me today and what God has prepared for me for tomorrow, everything from the past is poop? I count it but dung, that I may win Christ. That I may run to Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, not earning it of myself and my good works, which is of the law, but which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain the resurrection from the dead. He says, Paul even goes to the extreme. And this one, I grappled with this one. Because we want power. We want joy. We want experience. And so it's tough to come to somebody and say, live in death. No, live in Christ's death. It's a hard thing to say to someone. I'm bored already. Are you kidding me? I'm going to die now? And he says, Paul says, if I preach anything, if you hear anything from me, I preach Christ and him crucified. What is he saying? He says that daily he crucifies or puts to death himself. Every day he gets up and makes a decision. I am in Christ and he is my Lord and I will follow him. He's right and I'm not. Every single day he looks at the caterpillar. He says, that's not me no more. I'm a butterfly. I'm a butterfly. I will fly with the Lord. I will walk with God. Pretty awesome, huh? That's our attitude. I've always heard that, you know, have an attitude of gratitude, or you can choose your attitude. They always tell you that at work. Choose your attitude. It's really true. Joshua said, choose you this day whom you will serve. We have a choice now. Because of the salvation of God, we have the light. We can walk in it. We can do what's right. We should choose what's right. It's the Spirit that's been put within us. Do me a favor and turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Again, this is a scripture verse I already quoted to you, but I want to read it more in its context. And this is that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. So starting in verse 17, when we get there. It says, beginning in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation. He's embraced you as prodigal children, but now he's asked you to go reconcile others unto him. He's giving you a job. Are you bored? Are you not in church? Are you not in Bible study? Are you not in prayer? I would probably say you're not in the battle. You've consumed your time doing something else other than reconciling others unto Christ. We talk about baptism, and the Bible says that we're to go throughout the world, all nations, and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Right? Making disciples. We're called to make disciples. What does that mean? Immersion. Immerse. I'm no longer, there's nothing living out. You know, when we baptize, we don't do a little sprinkle of the water around and hope to hit you in the eye and chew over there, chew over there, chew over there. No, we say, down you go, bury, completely, down, now up, yeah, you're down. We put you under, completely immersed, changed, forgotten, old, washed away. Not this little sin sticking up that you're going to remember that Satan's going to use as a foothold to hurt you. You're changed completely. Your DNA has been put into a primordial soup, if you will. I hate that because it's evolutionary, but the reality is your DNA has been changed. And now it's imaginative cells that the Lord brings you back up and makes you a new creature. You're awesome. You're God's creation. Every single one of you, reconciled, redeemed, put back in his arms of love, torn from the world of sin and shame and guilt. Leave that behind in the muddy dirt where it belongs. All things are reconciled to God. It says, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciled in the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. He hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors of Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead to be reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So we have a new purpose, right? To walk in the righteousness of God. That's the thing. That's our target. This is where we're supposed to be going. Paul compares it to a race, and he says, I put it ever before me. I run the race. I finished well. This is what we're doing every day. We get up. It's not boring. It's a decision we have to make daily of who we are. It's not that we're saved multiple times. It's done once and for all. We talked about that. But it's our new nature. It's kind of like we talk about nature of sin. Sin is something that naturally does the wrong thing. It naturally misses the mark and brings death. Well, now we are natural reconcilers. Now we are natural lovers to bring people to the truth and knowledge of Jesus Christ. To show them who he is. To show them the way out. We're not to be continually exampling out death. It says in the second part of
verse 4, therefore we are buried in him by baptism of death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in the newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and henceforth we should not serve sin. You have the authority to rebuke sin and put to death. Just like that fruit tree as Jesus is walking into Jerusalem and it had no fruit on it. He said, be dead. And they came back later, a couple days or hours, whatever. It was dead. Completely dead. And he says, you think this is a miracle? He goes, I tell you, you'll do greater than these things. He's giving you power and authority. How many of us are walking lamely, man? This church is weak. Not this church. I'm saying the church is weak in America. They stink. They're putting on stinky pants, stinky clothes, and they're walking powerless, and they wonder why they have no power. They wonder why they have no authority. They wonder why nothing's different from the time of when I was first saved. I'm the same. I still have the same struggles, I have the same mentality, I have the same attitude, I have the same disobedience, I have the same nature, I have the same wantings that are consuming me. Are you being filled? Have you said, I'm wrong and you're right, Jesus? Have you been baptized in mercy? Have you been completely put under and risen in him by faith to be a new creature? Where is your time being spent? Where is your money being spent? Where is your words being spent? Are we new? Or are we just the same old, boring episode? Rerun. Treadmill. Going nowhere. Come on, guys. We don't have much time here. This is an exciting thing we have here before us, to be busy about our Lord's business and to change and to renew, to be reconciled unto him and to reconcile others. Verse 6 says, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and henceforth should not serve sin. Verse 7 says, for he that is dead is freed from sin. And if we be dead in Christ, we believe that we shall live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, we're going to close with this. It says, and you have been quickened who were dead in trespasses to sin, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of the world, according to the princes of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom we all had our conversation at times past, and the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, hath quickened us together, reconciled us with Christ by the grace which you are saved. And he hath raised us up and made us sit together in heavenly places with Jesus Christ, that in the ages to come we might show exceeding riches of his grace and kindness towards us through Jesus Christ. For the grace by which you are saved through faith, and not of yourself, is a gift from God. We talked about this last week, the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are workmanships created in Christ Jesus unto good works. We've been created for good works by him who's making you in his image, which God hath foreordained as we walk, that we should walk in them. Are we walking in the good works of the Lord? Paul says, I've not yet arrived.
I've not yet achieved. I don't own this yet. But by faith, I know it's mine. I know that there's a new purpose, a new place, a new time, and I'm going to do everything I can to get there. No matter what it is, I'm going to think of others above myself. I'm going to walk as the Lord has called me to walk, as a new creature, non-selfish, non-lusting after things for me. Instead, I'm going to try to benefit others. And am I doing something that's beneficial to others if I'm living in my liberty? That's the biggest lie that Satan tells us, guys. Look, I know I'm meeting them where they're at. I've been there. I've literally led people to Christ while I was sitting at the bar getting drunk with them. Literally. Where are they now? They're not walking with Christ. He gave his heart then. He came in. Listen, this isn't a play act. It's where are you? Are you here? Are you walking? Is it new? Are we elbow to elbow in prayer saying, I have a hard time here, guys. Help me. Pray. Why do people like Danita, who's always praying and inspiring me, help me. I'm falling. Why? Because she's in the race. Because she sees it. She knows where her flesh nature is, and she says, I rebuke it. I want it dead. Thank you, Danita. Thank you for those that are honest and that are walking upright and calling evil evil and good good. They want what's new, not the old nature. Thank you, sister, brothers. Let's walk upright. Let's encourage one another to be the newness that God's called us to be. The world is doing what the world's going to do. But we need to be peculiar and different ambassadors of Christ. Amen? Let's do this. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you that all things are possible through Christ Jesus. We thank you that you've done the good work in us and have started it and will complete it to the day of our return. We thank you, Father, that you love us even more now that we're your children, even though we still sin, even though we fall short of the glory of God. We know, Father, because of you, we're imputed righteousness. I pray, Father, that we would cast off and rebuke, eschew evil or hate it, and love righteousness. Help us. Change us, Father. Help us to come together in fellowship. Help us to be in the battle that we would see the newness and the excitement it is to walk with you. Father, I thank you, and also help us to have a heart for the lost, for the children, Lord God, and the church, that we would care, that we would be tenderhearted, that we would show the love of Christ in our actions, and we'd be careful not to stumble anyone. We thank you and praise you for the work that you're going to do in us. In Jesus' name.
Morning, when I Give me Jesus.